Okay, so this talk is actually two in one. It's my talk and Richard's talk, but they are all related. And you, if you keep that in mind, the one size does not fit all. Basically, we are talking about flexibility and about how to bring value in an industry that is more and more commoditized, and how meeting different needs is going to actually make the whole. I'm not talking about Juniper, but the whole open networking community to succeed, hopefully. So I will focus more in the enterprise market, and Richard is going to focus more in the service provider use cases. So let's start with enterprise, and more precisely with hybrid cloud. But in one of the advantages of in Juniper, we sponsor. We're one of the sponsors of an open source project called Tencent Fabric. Tencent Fabric is an SDN solution where we can implement, among other things, we can implement security policies in a seamless manner in a hybrid cloud, which means we can push the same policies to any hybrid cloud, any public cloud region, or to a private data center, right? So let's think about, okay, this is actually more of a debate. What can networking vendors, what kind of value can the networking vendors add in a public cloud era? So as you know, public cloud offerings such as AWS, Google, Azure, and the likes are more and more complete. So who in this room think that a networking vendor can bring value in such an ecosystem? Can you please raise your hands? Okay, nobody raised their hands, so I'm going to try to prove you wrong. Let's hope I succeed. Let's go step by step. First, what kind of technical challenges do we encounter? The main one is the public cloud provider is in full control of the network infrastructure, whereas the user of the public cloud is not. And product by a networking vendor is typically, you can consider it as a user of the public cloud, is using the public cloud APIs, right? Of course, the networking vendor can partner with the cloud provider for a deeper integration. A very common case is AWS with VMware. But of course, this is a business relationship. It's not an open networking thing, right? So it's another universe. We're not going to talk about it. A truly open solution would use the public cloud solution as it is, the APIs as they are. And I typically encounter two common issues when it comes to networking. First, the cloud provider decides what to forward and what to drop. And a very classical example is multicast. If you put a multicast packet in the public cloud infrastructure, it's going to typically be dropped, right? So we don't really own the network. It's the public cloud provider who does. And another example is, well, I was thinking, I'm not aware of any public cloud provider that offers true network load balancing. And if you look at AWS, there is a service that is called precisely like that, network load balancing, but it's TCP only. And as you know, networking is not connection-oriented. It's connectionless, by definition. It's a transport layer that can be connection-oriented, but not the networking layer. I know there's some noise about one thing called network service mesh. I deeply dislike it. And I'm not talking because I'm working for a given vendor, but I really personally dislike it. It's basically reinventing networking, which by definition is connectionless, into a connection-oriented paradigm, which I think it will never work. But anyway, let's see. Maybe I'm proven wrong, right?
And it will never scale, so.
Yeah, but anyway.
This is the other pillar of networking. Mm-hmm.
So basically, yeah, that's very important because the fact that there is no real network load balancer in the public cloud providers imposes a limit in scaling out and redundancy. So, okay, so let me rush. Is it possible to bring? So, if you guys have any similar challenge, please come after the presentation, and we can discuss. So, is it possible to bring value? I think, of course, it is. It is more possible to bring value now than in probably in 10 years, but we definitely can bring value. And I'm going to bring one example of one of the added values that we can add. So here there's a very typical scenario, maybe even too simplistic, but here there's an application with three layers. You can view each of these ovals as a Kubernetes service, right? And we have three tiers, and each of the three tiers is replicated across two regions and across three different deployments or environments: development, testing, and prod. So imagine we want to apply a security policy where we can allow web to app engine to database, but we don't want to allow from web frontend to database. That's very simple, right? Very simple policy. But what if we are adding more values, more variables, more dimensions? The sites, India and US, and the deployments, dev, test, and prod. How are we going to define those policies so we can prevent traffic going crossing environments or crossing sites? How can we achieve that? So the classical solution, if you look at what public cloud providers are doing and most implementations are doing, is based on security groups. So basically, we have to label or flag each of the services at each location with a different security groups. And we have to define, basically, if you see, we have to define 8 security groups, right? With one rule each. This is a very simplistic case, but if you see, it's only two sites, only three deployments. Imagine we add more variables. Imagine we add more complexity. This just simply explodes. And when we were developing Tansync Fabric, and one of our customers said, "Okay, this doesn't scale. You guys come with someone else, with something else." And there is Prasad, who was supposed to be here, but I guess he was busy with something else, who invented one thing that is called multi-dimensional security. And it may look similar to things that you may see from Google or from VMware, but it's not. So basically, the whole policy can be implemented with two rules. One rule is from web to app. The other rule is from app to DB. And match. Deployment and site. We're not saying the name of the deployment. We're not saying the name of the site. We're simply saying that it has to match. It looks like a super simple idea. It is a super simple idea. But surprisingly, I haven't found it in any implementation in the industry except for Tansync Fabric. So one of the things that Prasad told me, Prasad is basically the inventor of that concept, Prasad told me, can you please ask whether a Kubernetes community can adopt this and implement this idea also in Kubernetes? Why Kubernetes and not OpenStack? Well, maybe OpenStack too, but you know, the world is shifting to Kubernetes. So this is openness, and let's go for it, right? And in Tansync Fabric, you can, which is, again, it's an open source product. You can consume by yourself. You don't have to pay anything. If you want support, etc., of course, you are welcome to search it from one of the official or one of the maybe companies who provide that support. But this is the kind of visualization that we get. And there is yet another debate that I wanted to add before giving the word to Richard. Is there can be added value. This was just an example. This multi-dimensional security is just an example of added value that we can add and that public cloud offerings today don't add. There will always be opportunities like that. So where do we implement the added value? Do we implement it at the workloads or at the region border using a gateway or at a hub region in the sense that we attract the traffic from different regions into a hub region where we implement the added value? Well, every solution is possible, and especially in an open source product. It may be not be implemented there yet, or it may be, but they all have pros and cons, which are a bit out of the scope of this presentation. But if you guys are interested tomorrow to see a hybrid cloud deployment where we have, in this case, we have a distributed Kubernetes cluster across on-prem and public clouds with Kubernetes, OpenStack, and VMware, just let me know and we can arrange the time for tomorrow. So I'm going to give the word to Richard.
Hi, everybody. So thank you, Ato, for presenting this enhanced security framework. One thing you may wonder is, well, how can we manage security with just tags? You know, what does it mean? How can it propagate across the network? How can we handle that? And the answer is actually, I mean, behind that, behind Tungsten Fabric, we have a very powerful control plane. We have a networking control plane, which is BGP. And what we do, what BGP allows us to do, is simply that alongside with the prefix advertisement, your VM IP, your container pod IP, you can add some properties. So these are communities. And in this community, you can transport a tag. So anyone is in the network knows how, you know, he gave the example of different back-end, front-end, web. Oops.
I kind of like disconnected.
You gave different example of, you know, tags that you found as a, you know, location or type of developers versus pre-prod, etc. And web app and database. So these are just, this information can just get populated across the network and be shared by every compute node to take a local decision whether I can or not forward the packet to this guy. So it's very powerful. You implement distributed security, so it scales a lot. It's very powerful. So here,
can I ask a question to the audience? Can you guess in a networking paradigm with BGP how we are propagating the information of site, tier, and deployment using BGP? This workload has these attributes. How do you think we can do it with BGP?
I said it already.
Okay.
So this is community. Yeah?
Communities. Yeah. Mm.
So we have extended community for that. Mm. It's I know.
Sorry.
Yeah, no. It's a value, but yeah.
Yeah.
You can see like that, right? Mm. It's just a value, 32-bit value. Mm. So here, I mean, it's quite interesting. We see that at the scale of a multi-cloud environment, you can have a common security implementation across all types of different locations. And we can wonder, proceed into the exploration with DSP, because DSP is very different use case. I mean, it's vast, it's massive, and the main difference with SP service provider is the number of location. I mean, it's very high, right? It's thousands, or tens of thousands of locations. So, and for this purpose, I mean, I know it's not the appropriate track. There's another one dedicated to that, but the Edge Cloud is a very, very good example of what's going on at SP level. So, interestingly enough, we saw above, like the, you know, the public cloud designs that Atto presented. So now we'll have a look at the telco use case, and there is a unique opportunity for telcos today to monetize their network, their asset, all these sites that they have everywhere. Currently, there is an ongoing 5G transformation where. What used to be network function, physical network function, are moving to virtualized workloads, right? Whether it is containers or virtual machine, this is a fact. And 5G, the way vendors, network vendors package their application for 5G, now is virtualized. It's no more, you know, physical devices. And the impact of that is that this is the genesis of the telco cloud. Oh, now, DSPs must build their stacks. They must build their x86 with virtualized environment, SDN stack, to host this virtual function. And so they will be the first users of this infrastructure. And in parallel, we have this new 5G challenge in terms of new service that we want to propose, especially the ultra-low latency communication, and also we have requirements of very, very high throughput. So some application cannot, if you think a super high throughput, like a car that requests hundreds, I don't know, 1 gig of analytics to export every day, it's very hard to do that in a public cloud. You may want to have this thing processed closer to the end user so you don't saturate your network. Or simply we have the use case of latency. And so here you have the diagram of a network. You have your user with various these IoTs, cell phone, whatever. And then you have this regional POP, which is usually where today, where the physical functions are, where your sessions are terminated and aggregated. The 5G transformation moves all these functions closer to the edge. And this is a requirement just to cope with the very high throughput. We want to distribute more. We want to be able to host more subscribers. And in parallel, we have this latency that increases automatically the further you get from your subscriber. And we have, at the level of the aggregation today, in metropolitan POP typically, we have what we call this sweet spot where some application cannot be executed if the latency is higher than that. One example is typically a virtual reality where people just feel sick, they get dizzy if the latency is above, I mean, the threshold was found to be around 20 milliseconds. Mm-hmm. And these applications are unique. I mean, it's a great opportunity for telcos because this cannot be hosted in public cloud typically. Mm-hmm. The latency will be too high and the control of the latency mm-hmm. is even worse. The jitter, it's completely chaotic. So there is a unique opportunity for service provider to host new application that are outside their usual business, right? They will be like a customer application. On this telco cloud, you will have the 5G application typically to handle the traffic, to process everything, what we do when we just have a cell phone or internet. But on top of that, also the external application, we can call them like that. And all this has to be done. And the challenges behind that is that we have to handle mobility for this application and the number of sites. And this is where the problem gets super complicated. And this is where you need a single unified security framework that can be also automatically populated everywhere, because we are dealing with here regional POPs is tens of sites, 30, 50, depends on the country, etc. Here the unit is thousands, and here hundreds, and here thousands. So we are dealing with, you know, thousands of sites, 10,000. It's a lot. And if you don't have the right solution, it's super challenging. So our vision for that is to have a single infrastructure that is shared, that is seamless between all these sites. And Tungsten Fabric helps you to achieve that. Why? Because it's relying on the de facto standard of the backbone architecture, which is MPLS and MPBGP. What we do, we push MPLS up to the VM. So we use, of course, in the data center, some IP tunneling to carry the MPLS inside because the switch are not MPLS ready, etc. But at the end of the day, what we do, we extend the backbone up to the VM or the containers. So it's extremely powerful because, as I said, the communities can in BGP can be used to populate the security rules. So you can imagine that we are able to dispatch security rules across a huge set of location in a very seamless and automated fashion. There is no centralized controller that we have, you know, to query every flow, which will never scale with millions of flow. Mm-hmm. No, it's just simply populated automatically by the protocol.
Asynchronously, right? Asynchronously. That's the key.
Yeah, asynchronously, exactly. And because in parallel, we can see also some, we don't believe much in the vertical integration in this context. It means like I buy this stack from this vendor and this other stack from this vendor. Okay, it's fully integrated every time. There is the full stack from the orchestration to the VNF configuration manager or whatever. But how to deal with the number of sites? How to do that over thousands of sites with all the stitching problem you can have between the different sites? It looks very challenging. So this is why we definitely want to build a single infrastructure layer to handle everything. So if we zoom a bit on how we can distribute the telco cloud, because the challenge is there, we have two main architecture for that. The objective is to reconcile the cluster and the locations, right? So we have a model that is proven, it's there for a long time. In networking, we know that. We can interconnect data centers through Backbone MPLS. We have the toolkit for that. It's not a problem, but the problem that we have, as I said, there are thousands of sites. Do we want thousands of clusters? Well, the guy who does that, I mean, he does that and then he runs away, he hides himself for the rest of his life because you just cannot operate it. You cannot upgrade thousands, tens of thousands of clusters. It's just not possible.
And then there so, you also have the consistency. You have to keep consistent whenever you use a community to represent a given application tier, whatever. It must be the same community on the other cluster. It becomes a mess.
Mm. Yeah, as I said, the community semantics is per cluster basis, what he showed. So here you need to maintain some logic between the different communities, some translation, it becomes very complicated. So this is why we introduce, and we have patented that actually, there is a technique that we call remote compute, where a single cluster, so it's a single tungsten fabric, for example, Kubernetes, but we can completely abstract the physical locations. It's fully integrated, and here you can pack several locations in the same cluster. So it means, from a life cycle perspective, okay, I can pack 50 locations here.
Does this assume that the overlay network is tungsten fabric, and you're using hardware routers that are also Juniper?
Yeah. So, well,
and there is no Cisco router in there or a public internet in there in between?
Yeah, you need, what is, this is a good question. Depends on the vendor support. You need to support MPLS over UDP.
Or GRE.
We do that.
Or GRE. MPLS over GRE.
Or MPLS over GRE, but, you know, for performance, MPLS over UDP is better. Depends on the use case, but yeah, you'll be more comfortable with full Juniper because we know we support all that because we validate this stack. But if you support, and this is just at the what we call the gateway, you're right. On the local side, you have a Juniper router or any router that support MPLS. We have tested with actually other vendor like Nokia, for example. But
or Cisco, yeah.
Yeah, on Cisco as well, but. It's not fully aligned in our CI/CD. I mean, you can imagine that behind that. In terms of validation, we don't do that in a frequent fashion. But this is just the gateway. The backbone can be any kind of things. Or you can also do regular stitching, like VLAN stitching also, if you just want to abstract all this. It's less automation, of course, but at some point, yeah.
So you don't run MPLS over UDP over the backbone?
No. No, we won't. Exactly. That's very, very good comment. This is a real integration in the backbone. Mm-hmm. So you have MPLS over UDP at the edge because here you need to transport the traffic over IP switch. You know, switches that just route IP basically. And then here it terminates at your gateway level and it just becomes MPLS over MPLS, regular MPLS over segment routing, whatever you like.
So there was some debate of whether we should speak about MPLS or not. MPLS is kind of demonized. It's like, oh no,
is it the case?
MPLS is the past. No, false.
Is it demonized? Who thinks the MPLS is a demon here? Let's see.
Good. Who thinks it's not a demon? Cool.
It's, anyway, I mean, whatever the opinion or SRV6, whatever. I mean, today this is the standard. The backbone of any ESP in the world is MPLS. It's just a fact, right? Mm. So this is where it's very interesting to have a seamless integration with the backbone. Mm-hmm. So and how if we zoom a bit more on this architecture on the right. What we do, we have introduced the concept of subcluster, actually. And this is how we partition. It's a construct that allows us to partition a full cluster, so this is the green box you see, into, subclusters. One cluster is split into subclusters. And in this subcluster, what we find, you find the compute that pertains to a given site, of course, the gateway of a given site. So this is this router that it's a PE in the backbone, right? It's the first router in the backbone. It does MPLS over UDP on one side and MPLS over MPLS on the other side. And in the middle, we spawn a dedicated router function. We call it control node in Tungsten Fabric. But it's basically a router, and we spawn a new instance. So it has its own table of the routing, but from the perspective of routes received from the local gateway. And it will export also to this gateway only the local computes, because these are simple peering, you know, signaling session in terms of routing. And this is how, and of course, between this gateway, you must imagine that you have the MPLS backbone with which the exchange of route will be made automatically, right?
So this the is reason, the reason why we have subclusters is that we cannot support a full mesh of control sessions, BGP, all over the place. We really need to be practice some economics, and also the next hop for a given prefix varies site per site, so we don't we cannot have like a single control plane pushing everything. We need to have some kind of like a distributed control plane, yeah, the way networks scale actually.
So this is a logical construct, right? So if we see how it is implemented in reality, I have an example here. We actually want, we consider we have a model where we have bigger location, bigger POP data center, and like remote location, which are small sites, closer to the edge typically, where the cost of CPU is much higher. So the idea is to put all router function, these new routers that we have instantiated, in the data center, in the big POP where the CPU is cheap, in order to keep in the, you know, far edge POPs only the compute resources. All control functions are kept at a higher level for economic reason, because here definitely the cost is higher. It's more OPEX to come and change the CPU, operate, etc. So, and if we compare this horizontal diagram here, we have this relationship in terms of peering. You can find it back here. This gateway sends the traffic there and it's going back here. There are two for redundancy. I'm done.
Okay, so unfortunately there's no time for Q&A, but we can have the Q&A after the session.
You have 1 minute for Q&A.
1 minute for Q&A,
That's
yeah.
So you have a actually, I mean, this is a topic usually take half a day when you have a, you know, workshop with customer on this topic. So it's a super challenge to do that in 10 minutes. I was like, I had this huge deck. I was like, what do I delete? What do I delete? What do I delete? So I tried to make it as quick as possible, but it's a challenge. So.
Guess what? Service provider will always be more complex than enterprise. Always. In networking terms.
Any question? If you're too shy, you just come and see us afterwards.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right, thank you.